don't even have a word for it. Oh my goodness, you can't stand them. They're worrisome. They're picking, nitpicking, and it's kind of like, did I do something to you today?
You're reaching thousands of people in seconds.
We have, say, skeletal remains.
Suspect information.
Serial stabber.
Slum and sludge.
Young child got shot in the backseat of a car.
I'm waking up to ash and dust. I wipe my brow and I sweat my rust. I'm breathing in the chemicals.
Times police officers are just like regular people and they get information about what's going on in communities simply from the media reporting. An officer in one jurisdiction might know of a similar crime occurring in another jurisdiction because the media reports it. Other times the media can have an effect on criminal investigations actively because the media might be sought out by police in the middle of an investigation to seek their help in disseminating, you know, information to members of the community. A lot of tips coming out through our local Crime Stoppers, just giving out information. If anybody has any of this type of information, call in, because the police are at a dead end.
One of the things that we try to get out in the media quite a bit is missing persons cases. And so if we have someone that has gone missing, you try to get a photograph of them on the news. And otherwise, someone might, I'd be able to identify them. Or if we have, say, skeletal remains, we're trying to figure out who that person is. We can do things like facial reconstructions, get those out in the media and say, does anybody recognize this person? Kind of that, you know, side of the milk carton type thing. And without media exposure, those questions are never answered.
There's a good and a bad, let me say that right off the bat. Media can be good, media can be bad.
From the view of the crime lab, where scientific evidence is coming into play, we sometimes have problems with the media misrepresenting what is there. A lot of what we do in forensic science is very technical, and I've certainly had many instances where the media gets things wrong.
The idea that the media doesn't operate with the same rules of proof and evidentiary requirements, even when people hear fair and balanced, you know, from some of the media stations.
If we are out there and we know there's someone dead, or we know there's this big accident, I mean, we're going to try to, they're going to make us do a story. We're out there, we're going to do something. And when we run into problems, it's a lot of times because the police didn't say a word, and the media agencies are going to try to tell the story, and then sometimes the wrong information gets out.
Sometimes what you say to them can get distorted, or that's not what you really said, and they twist it just a little bit. So it's a thin line. A lot of times when you're dealing with media, you get nervous sometimes.
There's a right way to do things and a wrong way to do things, just like any occupation. I always say that. I mean, it's because people who complain about journalists, you can complain about attorneys, real estate agents, car salesmen, police officers, anything. You know, there's a right way and a wrong way, and you have to be very careful with the words you choose, the sound bites you choose, the way you frame your story to try to be objective.
Yeah, you don't want to add fuel to the fire if there's a really sensitive situation going on, or, you know, people have kids always conjure up a lot of emotions, so you really have to be careful. But they can also help to get more information. And you know, our job is not to take sides and point fingers, but to just tell the story and as factually as we're able to.
So what they really rely on is a police organization and a police spokesperson to define for them what information they should have about a case. Okay, so that to me is a restriction. I think there's some sort of legal restrictions. There's real ethical restrictions on media organizations. There's also sort of organizational process in terms of how they collect information.
We have to be very careful to make sure that if we're talking about a criminal trial, that the jurors who are sitting on that criminal trial are making their decisions free of mm-hmm. the influence of the media. When we did the serial stabber case locally, and then also we had a kind of an infamous case of child abuse. In the serial stabber case, we had juror questionnaires. Every juror had to fill out a questionnaire and tell us what they knew, had that caused them to form a particular opinion, and could they still be fair and impartial based upon anything that they knew in the media. That's why I say, in that little bubble, I don't ever think there's anything that media can't do positively, because I don't want any effect from media at all.
They should not have access to anything that could be damaging to the case, to the investigation, be it in the beginning or in the end. If you think it's something that's going to hamper the case, then you probably need to keep it to yourself, because you know they can, it depending on how they put it out there,
right,
as to how it can hurt you or help you. Don't screw me over, because just how you need me, I need you, it goes vice versa. So yeah,
I think we have a role to play if the police are interested in using us in that way, in terms of being able to get out pictures or suspect information or anything that could lead to information that could be helpful in their investigation. So if used the right way, and if they're certain about a certain individual, then you know, we certainly reach a lot of people both on air and online. So
we do need them. We need, a lot of times we're looking for someone or we need to get some information out, and we call them and they're right there. And sometimes it's like you don't really want to be bothered, because, not that you don't want to be bothered, but I really don't have anything for you right now, so would you please quit calling me? And the phone is steady jumping, it's steady ringing, and it gets to be aggravating. So yeah, it's kind of like it can get to be a love hate.
I think a lot of times there's a lot more that we do know that we can't say, especially when we work well with police, and it's important that they trust you with that information, because then I think you can tell a better story if you know the background.
You know, if you have a good relationship, they can help guide you without saying too much, and then you can do a better job because you know the backstory, mm-hmm. actually.
I do think that outside of the pendency of a particular criminal case, then the media has a great power to put a positive light on what we as criminal prosecutors do, what police officers do in their communities to bring people to justice, to bring closure to victims, and to do things like that.
If people realize what happened, they see the crime tape, they see something going on, if they realize the backstory, then a lot of times the community will come together and try to find tips and, you know, help out with the investigation or raise money for the families or that kind of mm-hmm. thing. So
the next time there's another case coming up or an investigation or something like that, and maybe we can use you, and I'll always remember, you know, they really did a good job on this, or they did a good job on that, whereas this other media person or station or whatever, they just kind of haphazardly stated this, stated that, never had their facts right, and so forth like that. So,
but in the serial stabber case, it's very likely that we may never have solved that case, or not solved it in time to have the result that we did, were it not for media. Mm-hmm. So at that phase, when it's still in the investigation and it's the police working with the media to bring in new facts and items to investigate, then media almost always has a positive effect on a criminal investigation, because it's bringing in new points mm-hmm. to investigate. As the case kind of grew and became a lot more noteworthy, there was a greater amount of media interest just in what was going on. I think media had a big effect when it was able to let the community know that someone had been caught in relation to this case. We actually had a downturn in crime in the area when the case was being investigated, because I think a lot of people were afraid to be out on the street, so it's kind of driving people indoors once the media was able to be that outlet.
Well, they had that sketch that the state police did, and that was on our air in every newscast for, absolutely, I mean, a couple different times. And, you know, it's not just our newscasts, it's Facebook and Twitter and any other social networking site you can think of. It's all over the place. And, you know, that I think that's the biggest thing I can think of is the sketch. And then when they had the picture of his SUV or his Blazer, that was running all over the place.
The police followed up on every tip, even after we got the tip number 316 that ended up being the one that kind of cracked the case. You have to suffer through all of the misinformation that comes in to maybe hit that one diamond, mm-hmm, that becomes the case cracker. Yeah. To be there in the beginning to help, to assure the community that it's safe, to kind of leave us alone and understand that there's only certain things that we can do while we try the case, but then to be there to complete the picture afterwards once the verdict's, mm-hmm, in. Then I think it is important that to a certain extent, in a very neutral way, the media at least reports what's going on in an event of community significance. Mm-hmm. That someone was caught, that someone was charged, that a trial is upcoming, and here's the result of the trial.
To put out the facts as they are, unbiased, not to know what to put out, where to get their information from, to make sure that it's reliable and it's not hearsay, you know what I'm saying, coming off the gossip line or something like that. You know, just investigate it, make sure that it's the right thing.
Those investigative reports are system changing. All right, it means that an innocent person that was put behind bars gets out, or it changes police practice, or it changes prosecutorial practice. It informs the people about injustices within the system, and the system changes for the better because of a story. And that, to me, is the real exciting and the promising thing about the media, and the media's interesting. I like that police organizations are willing to be scrutinized and giving access to reporters to sort of think about their organization. It keeps them on their toes to know that the media is watching.
You're reaching thousands of people in seconds, and so you just have to be careful about how you get the information out there so as not to, you know, get it in the wrong way.
That's why it's so important that we are accurate, and that, you know, sometimes there can be different things that you're not quite sure of. I mean, that's one thing about our station. Sometimes we can be conservative, and it's, you know, frustrating because you want to break a story, and we do break a lot of stories, but when we do, we know what's right. We just really try to, especially, I mean, like I said, Lori, this is her passion. She's the crime reporter. She has a relationship with all the police officers, and our station is a trusted station in our area, I believe. And I think that that's because we try so hard to make sure when it's out there that it's an accurate story, because you never want to get the wrong information out, especially something this sensitive.
I sweat my rust, I'm breathing in the chemicals.